So I got lucky first time, I got lucky the second time, and with this picture, what they had, I have gotten lucky a third time.
Let me just take you back to the beginning of your film career, because you just came out of the gate swinging with one big project after another. I would say Reflections in a Golden Eye, Stalking Moon the next year, Medium Cool. I mean, amazing. You know, when you hit the ground running like that, what was going through your head here?
I didn't have a clue. I went to New York City without having a plan or a clue. And I didn't know how lucky I had gotten. I didn't know there were this many actors and this many jobs. I said to myself, how hard could it be? Kids can do it. I could do that. And I went to New York with no plan at all. I took a rented room for $9 a week. Yeah. I was a substitute teacher back in Rochester. I would teach 3 or 4 days. It was $26 a day. You could make enough to go back to New York for 3 or 4 weeks. And that's what I did for a while, until I met an actress who wanted me to do a scene with her in a class. Mm-hmm. We did the scene for an agent then, and the agent handed me over to a casting director and said, see if you can get this job. And I introduced myself to the actor, and I got the job. So I was on Broadway in 1965 in a two-character play, Mrs. Dalley Has a Lover. Uh-huh. Along comes Zanuck, the elder.
Daryl
Zanuck. Yeah. We do a screen test. He puts me under contract to 20th Century Fox. I was one of the last contract players at Fox.
Wow.
I got married to the girl I was in love with from college. We drive out. We take an apartment. The first phone call is from the agent. He said, do you know who John Huston is? I said, no, I don't. He says, well, he's a big guy in this business. He wants to meet you for Reflections in a Golden Eye. I won't make it a long story, but I go to New York.
With Elizabeth Taylor and Marlon Brando.
Yes, it was originally going to be Montgomery Clift, but he died and was replaced by Marlon Brando. So I hadn't a clue what was going on, except that I got more lucky. And when I tell a story, I say to myself, That's like a dream. Yeah. And it went that way, one step after another, from Reflections in a Golden Eye to, and then my career sort of tipped over and started going down. It didn't stop going down for 27 years until I was sitting in a coffee shop on Santa Monica Boulevard.
You go there every day to that.
Every day, you got to have a place to be, and that place closed. And then I went across the street to another place, but I had been there for more than 20 years or so. Yeah. And in walks Quentin Tarantino, and I had auditioned for Reservoir Dogs, so I knew what he looked like. And and I saw him over there, and I yelled at him, and he came over, and we blah blah, and I asked him what he was doing, and he said he was doing an adaptation of Rum Punch. He said, Elmore Leonard novel, why don't you read it? And I did. 6 months later, I walked in, and he was sitting in my spot, Quentin, and before I even got to the table, he lifted up the script, and he handed it toward me. He said, read this, see if you like it. So, the first part of my career, and that were things that, were out of a dream.
You took a lot of jobs that you might not have, right?
Oh, I have 4 kids. I took any job I could get.
Is that right?
And yes, and on the descend, every job was less and less and less. Yeah. And so, you do as many things as you possibly can to support the family.
Does that help you as an actor, though, to be constantly working and doing your craft no matter what?
Yes, I'm sure it does. Anytime you get a chance to get on a set and create a shot, because, you know, movies aren't shoot a movie. You shoot shots, 15, 20, 17, 19 shots in a day.
Yeah.
Each shot is a little tiny piece of that movie, a fraction, and got to be met with being fluid, and you have to know what the writer intended and what the director needs of you, and you got to be in the lights. The guy who set the lights wants you to be there, and the one be listening to the words got to hear them correctly. You owe something to everybody on that set. And when you create a stroke that advantages everybody on the set, including the one who's cutting the picture and who wants this roller coaster of a movie to have its ups and downs, and you got to contribute to them, every time you do that, you have a chance to create a jewel or Or less.
So as you say, a third time lucky. I don't think it's luck.
No. Trust me, there is. It cannot be other than luck involved. Yes, you got to get lucky.
So how did this role come into your life, Bert? You play the husband of Blythe Danner, who is now going in the stages of Alzheimer's, dementia, and the kids, the growing-up kids, want to move you both into a home. And you are absolutely in denial about that, but very protective of her, and do not want to do that. And it's a wonderful character.
It's a wonderful character. And and don't forget, the pool of actors my age is pretty shallow at this point. So I don't know who she might have had to pick from, but she claims to have liked me from the beginning, and I am gratified for something like that. Yeah. Yes, when anybody hires me a second time, and a few have, I always figure, boy, what a tasteful character there, what a tasteful person that is. And it was a wonderful role, and it was on paper. And you didn't have to do anything except believe in the words.
Yeah.
And the situation. She is a wonderful director.
So many people are going through this in their own families, and I think they will relate to this and relate to your character as well here.
It's the human condition. You know, first you're born and you can't take care of yourself. You have to rely on the ones who parented you.
Yeah.
And then for a while, and then you can take care of yourself. And then you're expected to take care of yourself. But for most of the arc of life, you have to take care of others. That's the job of being a human being, not what you do for a living and not what you do to amuse yourself. The job of caring for others is the job of being a human being until the very end, when you can no longer take care of yourself and have to rely on the ones you've parented. This was a movie about standing up for someone you love and wish to protect.
The great thing about the career of Robert Forster is that 100 years from now, we have a lot to look back on of what you've done on film, and it is well worth seeing again and again. Thank you so much for coming in, Actors.
You are a gent. Thank you, Pete.
Absolutely.